Welcome to Stitch, where we recognize the feel good, do good, and the all-around good from across the country. I'm Devontae McKenna, and some of us never grow out of the arts and crafts phase, and some are even lucky enough to turn their art into a business, from bespoke pieces to one-of-a-kind specialties. So put down the knitting needles, the hot glue gun, or whatever your tool of choice is, and meet some creative crafters. Here's Allie Ross to introduce our first artisan.
What started out as a hobby turned into a full-time gig for this Maine skateboarder.
Started this as a hobby. My best friend's wife has the first board I ever made. It's just made out of pieces of pallets.
Billy Landenberger makes skateboards from pallets or any piece of old reclaimed wood he can get his hands on.
It could be a piece of furniture, it could be a cedar fence. I oftentimes would use pieces of and parts from home projects that I did that otherwise would end up burned or in a landfill. And it gives it a second, you know, second life, so to speak. But the uniqueness of the wood and how they're pieced together is unlike anything. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Oftentimes there are 9. You get the edges. So 9 pieces of wood that comes from various places.
Each board is completely unique and can take up to 10 days to make.
So you could line them all up together and they, you know, might look a little bit similar, but everyone's unique in its own way, whether it's the grain pattern of the wood or whether it's nail holes or, you know, you can still see some of the grain left over from the planing process.
The long boards come with a reminder that only reclaimed and scrap wood were used to build it. No lumberjack needed.
The idea was, I guess, born out of, you know, sustainability or using kind of what was already here. And, you know, the more we can project that message to the people that are buying these boards, I mean, they're great boards and they're cool looking.
Our next unexpected entrepreneur from Georgia went from having fun to making funny money.
I thought I'll do one or two of these a week and, you know, we'll go out to dinner, right? With like the money I make, but now it's gotten very elaborate.
Brian Walker didn't expect his metalworking hobby to become a full-fledged business. It wasn't until a slow-moving animal sold quickly that he realized there was money to be made.
Sloth up there was actually the biggest thing that I ever sold. I posted that on Reddit and sold like 17 of them in a day. And when you're doing one at a time, you know, and they take a little while, that was a pretty big deal, like right at the beginning.
House numbers, personalized signs, ornaments, you name it, Brian makes it. And another big hit, a sauce holder for your car.
Tip while you drive, if you will, right?
It's perfect for people eating on the go, designed to fit most fast food dipping sauces and made for easy cleanup.
Dozens of these every week. I mean, like they go out every day. Like I ship these all over the country now.
Brian says enjoying the process is what matters most.
As long as I keep making the things and I take it off and I'm like, all right, that's pretty, I like that I made that, and as long as it stays fun, then I'll keep doing it.
Our next creator from South Carolina sure is super, a superhero that is. Believe it or not, this isn't the actual Tony Stark. It's Emily Yared, an engineering graduate of Clemson University who has gone mega viral for her superhero suit recreations. It started out simple with just foam and super glue.
When I was 14, I just got really bored one summer. I had just seen the Avengers and I saw a lot of people online making suits out of foam. And then even after that, I was like, I can still do better. So it's just kind of been a constant process of one-upping myself.
Since then, Emily has advanced to 3D printing to replicate the battle armor in real life. She upped the ante by modeling this version after Iron Man's appearance in Captain America: Civil War. She posted her process online and attracted hundreds of thousands of fans fascinated by the process.
It's blown me away with how overwhelmingly supportive it's been. 'Cause obviously, like, for things like that, I'm like, oh, what if people don't like, but like, they absolutely just kind of blew me away with that.
Then she started working on a blue Iron Man suit with LED lights, a working faceplate, an extended jetpack, and arm cannons.
You know, I don't know why the blue suit did it, but I guess it just did.
The day of her college graduation, she posted the video and it took off, to say the least.
I mean, I forgot about the fact that I graduated. I just completely forgot. But yeah, that was wild. That took me from 700,000 followers on TikTok to now 2.1 million.
Emily hopes the momentum of going viral will allow her to pursue her hobby full time.
I'd say all this has definitely been both fun and a blessing to be able to get to do.
Now, when you see this next artist's work, you'll be awestruck.
Chainsaw carving is my full-time occupation. It's fast, it moves quickly, and that's one of the reasons it's a good performance art. You have to be paying attention, your mind has to be going the whole time. You have to focus on what you're doing and tune out any distractions. It is almost like a meditation. My name's Gary Keenan. I'll be the main carver for the 2017 Iowa State Fair. I'd always had an appreciation for sculpture. Throughout my life, I'd look at sculpture and I'd say to myself, I know I could do that. That wouldn't be hard to do. And then a friend told me about the chainsaw carving right here at the Iowa State Fair 17 years ago. And I hadn't seen it, but I'd heard about it and I wanted to try it, thinking that I could do it. And so I started playing around with it and it just took off. I do love the outdoors, but it was more from the perspective I grew up on a dairy farm. We had all kinds of animals and we worked outside all the time. And so that was my appreciation for working with my hands and working with tools. I think there is a relationship between wood and the rustic subjects, that there's that connection of nature, that wood is an organic material with its own beauty, with its own colors for each species of tree. So I think that's what helps animals be so popular with chainsaw carving. The fair pays us a flat daily rate to carve. They own the carvings and they get auctioned off the last day of the fair. It goes into the Blue Ribbon Foundation, which helps rebuild and repair the fairgrounds. I had never dreamed that I'd be here. Life is too short. I just feel very lucky to have a career that I enjoy. I think that's too rare in today's world.
When we come back, we'll introduce you to some truly unique small businesses and crafters. Stay tuned.
Welcome back. We're showcasing some of the most incredible artisans from across the country. This next young creator found inspiration from one of the world's most beloved artists and his happy little trees.
At school, I missed art class.
Like many kids, Malik Harding missed his favorite subject in school when he was learning from home during this pandemic. Mom Ashley thought of a unique tutor, Bob Ross.
And that was also when I didn't have Bob Ross brushes.
He immediately started doing all those pencil drawings with it, and then he wanted the paint.
Malik instantly connected with the famous soft-spoken artist's videos. His favorite thing to paint?
Probably happy little trees.
People donated canvases for Malik's new hobby through a local Facebook page. Then one day, Malik had a new idea.
I didn't know what to do, and then I said, oh, Mom, I'm gonna make a game. You need to get 15 points out of the 10, 4, 2, and 8 points.
Using his artistic talents, Malik created a card game where players use ingredients to build recipes and win points.
When I saw all his drawings he made for it and how he's coming up with points, I'm like, oh, we better like do something with this.
At first, the game was popular among friends, then he was able to sell some and donate all of the money to the World Wildlife Fund. But now the game is for sale at Fort Good Vibes in his community and online. In addition to the artistic skills, Malik says Bob Ross taught him a very important lesson.
We don't make mistakes, just happy little accidents.
Her business may be salty, but you'll find this next artist's work pretty sweet.
Big or small, Sherry Hearn does it all.
Micro to maxi, I guess, yeah. But you have to have a lot of choices when you're making things, right?
Her studio is filled with all kinds of sea and beach materials she uses for her art.
Nice.
Just about every day, Sherry combs Maine beaches for new material to work with.
But there's always something. That's the beauty.
No beach, she says, is out of reach. In fact, she often paddles to more remote places. According to Sherry, that's where the treasures are most valuable.
I love to go to places where no one's walked down on those beaches, like cliffs and things. I feel like I found like a shipwreck with all these treasures. And then I just pack it up on my paddleboard and saddle up and paddle back.
She turns her trinkets and special finds into all kinds of art pieces, like a hand-painted sign or even her signature driftwood wreath adorned with sea glass.
This will take me forever to make it, and the process that you have to go through and the amount of wood, this will probably use between 350 and 500 pieces of driftwood.
Repurposing materials to make something beautiful is certainly part of the fun, but for Sherry, the treasure hunt may just be the best part.
I'm there to get the staple stuff, and then I find really good, just happen to find all this other good stuff, and I go, well, I have to take it with me.
A quality product, tradition, and exceptional craftsmanship are core tenets of this next family business.
Our boots are not throwaway products. I mean, you don't have them for 6 months and toss them and get a new pair. Dehner boots are custom-made quality. We did the first three manned spaceflight boots. We did all the boots for the space shuttle up until Challenger. We still make all the boots for the astronauts, just their everyday work boots. Reagan, we've always made his boots. Matter of fact, I think we've made more boots for him since he died than we did when he was alive, because they make these and they put them out in the museums. My name is Jeff Ketzler, and I'm the president and owner here at the Dehner Company. The Dehner Company is a family business. It has been in my family since the late 1800s. We do all kinds of custom boots, shoes, leather goods. The quality is absolutely the prime focus. Things just don't last anymore. They're built to fail eventually. That's one of the things that we still pride ourselves on, is we still use the right materials. We use the best leathers that we can find. We use the best insoles, linings. All the materials we have are absolutely always the best. I like to see people get 15 to 20 years wear out of them. One of the things that we still do a lot of is movies. We're doing this new movie, Deadpool 2. We made the boots for Brad Pitt and Fury. A couple of Stallone movies, he seemed to like our stuff. Me, myself, and Irene, because that was about the Rhode Island State Patrol, and of course we make their boots, so they came to us for those. We do a lot of things for New York Fashion Week. If boots are in this year, then of course they call us. It's always like a Where's Waldo type of thing with us, because you know everything that's going on, you know, we're just maybe a step away, but we're usually involved in it somehow or another. Businesses like ours are. They're going out of fashion. About the only place that I guess I get really sentimental or anything like that, I go back to my dad's office and look around in there, and that's when things get really wild. I'll go back there and hide out, because it's back in the quiet and away from everything else. So. When they pulled Saddam out of the spider hole, whatever they called it, one of the guys was wearing our boots. Sent us a picture of that. I thought that was kind of neat. Like I say, just, you know, maybe a step away, but we're there.
When we come back, we'll introduce you to the folks who are crafting for cause. We'll be right back. Welcome back. This next set of crafters use their creations to give back, whether that's raising awareness on a very important issue, providing job training, or simply benefiting their community. These artists are using their skills for good. First, a Nebraska couple hopes their toys will bring diversity and inclusion to the toy market.
If we can inspire a child by them seeing a product that looks like them, created by somebody that looks like them for them, then I feel like our mission is complete.
Everything made by Meraki Montessori is made with a whole lot of heart.
Everything we do with love.
And love is what inspired Ty and Rydell Nared's venture. They started by making toys for their daughter, Adele.
Then from there, we said, how cool would it be to offer these to our family and our community?
The duo make the handcrafted wood toys, like puzzles and play gems, right in their garage. They're made of eco-friendly and non-toxic materials. The couple is focused on safety, but that's not all.
Us being minorities, we have an understanding of our culture, our people, who we are, and we wanted it to be authentic. So we weren't seeing a lot of toys, I guess you could say, in the wooden toy arena that catered to that diversity. So that is something that we strive to do.
Woven throughout, items focus on diversity, inclusion, and representation, including the Melanin Mood collection.
So it's full of beautiful shades of brown. And currently in that collection, we have puzzles and cameras, as well as popsicles.
There are alphabet tiles in American Sign Language and a Native American focused collection.
We have friends that teach on Native reservations, and we created some custom pieces for their students. And we were inspired by that and just learning more about their language and their culture.
Beyond their mission for representation, Ty and Rydell are building a business and a legacy all for Adele.
To me, it shows her that the sky is the limit. She can do anything that she sets her mind to. We are really excited to have her watch and see what we do, because one day it'll all be hers, because it's all for her.
This next Baltimore crafter turned personal tragedy into a purpose to help others.
Destiny Macklin knows quite a bit about resilience. In 2001, her father died at the hands of one of his own employees.
The individual asked for him to stop by to pick up his last check, and He robbed my father, and my father became a victim of homicide the same night.
Destiny went on to become a police captain, but her career was cut short following an accident that left her with a lifetime of chronic pain.
Here I am, in seconds, my life is flipped upside down, and I felt like, for a second, I didn't have a purpose anymore.
Destiny got crafty, channeling her tragedies into tailoring. The hobby helped with the nerve damage in her hands and helped her build a sense of purpose.
Being a tailor and tailoring the lives of many African-American young men is the true divine purpose that I have here on this earth.
Her program Behind the Seams was born. Young mentees are given the outfit of their dreams and then paired with a mentor, setting them on the path to a future career. Destiny and her team not only build a connection, but confidence too.
From there, we present them to their family in a completely different way of how I met them. That means from top to bottom, that's haircut, that's mindset, attire, the way they walk, their confidence, all of this is redesigned to be the 2.0 version of themselves.
Investing in themselves and also their future, a belief the founder knows all too well.
And through this mess, I now have a message, and that is to just never give up.
In our next story, a Massachusetts organization is doing its part to help showcase the creation of all kinds of artists.
Ask Bryson Reck about his artistic process, and he likes to keep it hush-hush.
I can't tell you, it's a secret. My favorite's probably this one.
But his one-of-a-kind, handmade decorated shells speak for themselves. Bryson's mom, Lauren, says that he discovered his passion during a family trip.
We went to Florida, and the first day that we were there, he said, okay, I'm staying in the house.
Bryson has autism and sensory sensitivities, and is sometimes uncomfortable going outside. A bit of a treasure hunt was the encouragement that he needed.
The real hook was looking for shark teeth, sand dollars, and seashells. Then when we got back to the house, Bryson would use Sharpie markers, do different things to decorate the shells. Kind of came upon this idea together, let's make them more beautiful.
On a whim, Mom reached out to a local store called Parcels to see if they would sell Bryson's creations. The store is run by Northeast Arc, a nonprofit that offers a variety of services to people with different abilities.
People with disability and autism have the highest rate of unemployment or underemployment across the country. So by developing the store, we are purchasing items that are directly impacting people's pay.
Every product in that store is made by or sold through companies owned by people with disabilities or autism. The store also offers on-the-job training.
We'll work with people on the soup to nuts of what goes into retail and customer service.
Bryson's shells have now been flying off the shelves.
I kind of feel good about that.
Enough for him to buy himself a coveted Spider-Man costume.
And I think that gave him like the strength of a superhero. Like, I can conquer this fear of being outside. I'll wear, you know, my superhero costume and find shells.
In our final story, we visit a farm using modern technology to go old school and sustainable.
Most of us probably have no idea where our clothes came from or how they were made.
These sheep live 5 miles from our house, right? Like, I've met these sheep. And the furthest this sweater traveled was Putney, Vermont to get spun. And then it came right back here. Like, this sweater hasn't left Vermont.
Mother and son business duo Cyrus Brooks and Laura Jacoby, they are both out to change that with their company Muriels of Vermont. Laura actually grew up in Vermont with her mother, whom the business is named after. They grew their own vegetables, bought meat from the farmer next door, and hand-knitted their own clothing. a kind of life Laura was sad to see go.
I'm back from overseas, actually, and just saw how many dairy farms we're losing in Vermont. I mean, it's just alarming. And to see your childhood kind of disappear was very disturbing.
So this is a wool hemp blend.
So she took matters in her own hands. Muriel's of Vermont sells sweaters and summer knits made from wool and cotton sourced from three local farms.
We fill the bottom with warm water or whatever we're using. Depending on the fiber, we changed the finishing process. So each one of these squares represents a stitch.
After the sheeps are sheared and the wool is spun into yarn, Cyrus designs the clothes digitally and a knitting machine takes care of the rest.
We want to make sure it's as renewable and as ethical as possible.
The sustainable clothing gives back and educates its customers.
You can have a highly processed sweater that's been, you know, processed with a lot of chemicals and a lot of chemical dyes. All of that goes into the wastewater. Or you could have one that's been gently processed, naturally dyed, and, you know, and will last forever.
Thank you for joining us to celebrate these artisans and crafters from across the country. We hope these stories inspire some creativity of your own. From all of us here at Stitch, thank you so much for watching.